you gotta be smarter in what you're working with. Okay, let's post the colors, and we're all gonna do, Pledge of Allegiance, and then we'll do the national. So post the colors.
To the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly.
I'd like to thank all the students and the faculty for the breakfast that you put on. I sure appreciate that. I want to thank Rich Cummings from Blisties. He cooked the bacon this morning. He delivered it at 6:30, so I don't know what time he started. The Seaboard furnished all the bacon. Students greeted us at the door, brought us food. It was great. And I want to thank Ashley Clayton. She organized this whole thing. We have three speakers, and we're going to start off with Bentley, ninth grade. Where does America go from here? Ben?
What are the next steps for our nation? That's a question I've had to ponder and come up with an answer. The next step for our nation is to become more united along political lines, but also cultural and racial lines. According to a major past leader of our country, Abraham Lincoln, a house divided against itself cannot stand. As we make our way into the second year of President Biden's presidency, politics have turned into one of the most polarizing topics in the modern American nation. Since the topic has been extremely polarized, the ability of the legislature to pass bills to improve the life of the average citizen has been greatly diminished. A vast majority of the issues currently faced by our nation are often caused by faulty reporting in the journalistic sector. This is not necessarily a new thing, but has gotten worse as we've gotten further into the age of digital media. Digital media has made it a whole lot easier to publish misinformation and not facts. The average American had more education on the principles of both sides of the aisle. They might be more astute in telling the difference between fact and fiction. I believe that we need to be less divided along cultural lines and treat every human being with respect and dignity they deserve. Every human, no matter the color of their skin, nor what you do for a living, who they love, or even how they dress, deserve basic human rights and respect. To quote Martin Luther King Jr., I have a dream that my four children will one day live in a nation that where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. This quote is commonly disputed among people. I believe that it means that people should not be judged upon their outward experience, but upon how a person acts and behaves. These freedoms are often not equated among all people, and the same freedoms that our military has fought and died for. Many of us come from different cultural backgrounds, which could separate us. As a country, we need to acknowledge these differences and learn what we can do for each other. We as a country, there might be negative parts to some cultures, but we as Americans need to learn from those and take the good thing to become a better nation. Israel Zengel, a British playwright, once wrote, "America is God's crucible, the melting pot where all races of Europe are melting and reforming. Germans and Frenchmen, Irishmen and Englishmen, Jews and Russians, Americans can learn from each other in so many ways and work together to become a bright light upon the world stage. Not only do we have to reduce division along political lines, but also racial and cultural lines. That is the next step for our nation to take. This will not solve all of our national problems, but may solve a lot of the problems that we currently face. Thank you."
Martin.
Thank you for your service. I say to a veteran, appreciating soldiers is one of the greatest ways to be a good American. There are many other ways you could be good, but I think this is one of the best. I can be a good American by showing gratitude and respect to veterans by thanking them and honoring the flag. Thanking veterans for their service can show how grateful we are for them. Saying thank you to veterans can bring them joy. When I am in a restaurant and I see one, I always thank them for their service. They always have a smile on their face after I say it. My great-grandpa served in the Korean War, and he loved having people thank him for his service. For example, or reading books that they wrote can show how hard it is to train and to be in a war. For example, I am reading a book called I Am a SEAL Team 6 Warrior that was based off the memories of an American soldier. In my small town of Holyoke, on Memorial Day, it is tradition to decorate the cemetery with American flags on graves to show that we are thankful. The next reason to show how I can be a good American is by respecting the flag. Honoring and respecting the flag can help us remember what the fallen soldiers and veterans did for us. Every day before school, my principal gets on the intercom and asks us to stand for the Pledge of Allegiance. I always stand up, and in my mind, I think of what you men and women did. You all fought and put your life at risk for us. When I look at all the stars and stripes on the flag, I think of what kind of wars and pain you went through so we could have our country we have today. By giving thanks to veterans, I can show my gratitude and respect so I can be a good American. Thanking veterans can show how happy we are to have them in our lives. Respecting the American flag can show why we are so fortunate to have them. As a 14-year-old, it's easy to take for granted all the blessings that I have. My personal freedom is not only provided by God, but it is put into action by our veterans and soldiers. Thank you.
Now, Emmy Goldenstein.
One thing you can do to be a good American is to be patriotic and respect the Constitution. Obeying the laws and respecting other people's rights is also a way to be a good American. Taking care of the environment can also be a great way to be a good American. Being a good American is important so that our country is united and all citizens can enjoy the freedom of being an American. Being a good American means I show pride in my country and uphold the foundation of our country. Showing patriotism is something that should be done every day and reflected in our decisions, words, and actions, as well as considering how it will affect other Americans. Respecting the U.S. flag and government are also important ways to be patriotic. Obeying the laws that have been established for my country is a good way to be a good American. Showing devotion or support to our country is a big part of being a good American. A couple reasons that showing devotion or support to our country is important is because it keeps the moral of the country positive. It also helps our governments to run smoothly and make sound decisions. Another way is voting. Voting when you're older helps support the country by helping keep the democracy working as it was intended to. Showing bravery is a very important way to be a good American citizen. Not only do I have to show bravery, but my family, friends, teachers, peers, law enforcement, and soldiers have to show much bravery for this country. If we didn't show bravery, this country would probably fall apart. We have to show bravery to go into war, or more importantly, fight for our country and our freedoms. This country would be much harder to live in if we didn't have freedom, so being brave is something that is very important for our country. Showing bravery, devotion or support, having pride, and many more ways are how I'm a good American. What are ways you can be a good American?
Thank you.
speakers that I have asked. My name is Steve Millage, and I was in the Army. I thought I would just tell you a little bit about what went up to lead me in Vietnam, and then tell you what life was like in Vietnam. I was drafted, first of all, this time period, 1967-68, the service, the government drafted people to go in the Army. You had an exemption as long as you were in college. And once you graduated from college, then you're eligible for the draft. I graduated from high school in Holyoke in 1962, and I waited all summer for them to draft me. So I started my master's degree at the University of Wyoming. Got about 2 months into the semester, and they drafted me. So I went to the draft board and said, look, I'm in the middle of the semester, can I just finish this out, and then I'll go in the service. And they said, oh, when your name comes up, you have to go. So, I had a cousin that was in the service, and he was in military intelligence, and he said he liked it. Why don't you do something that you enjoy doing rather than, he had to sign up another year, so that's 3 years of doing something you like, rather than 2 years of doing something you didn't like. So I signed up for military intelligence, took a couple of tests, and went to AIT training in Baltimore, Maryland. They taught me how to interrogate prisoners of war and order of battle. Order of battle is where you take all the intelligence that you have available and you brief the general twice a day to keep him up on the events that are happening. At the end of the session, they asked me and about four other soldiers if we wanted to stay in Baltimore and teach incoming classes. We all had our orders in Vietnam, so we knew where we were going. But none of us decided to stay in Baltimore. It's just too far away from what I was used to. My family's here in Colorado. The humidity in Baltimore was unbearable. So we all went to Vietnam, and Vietnam was in the news constantly. So we've been listening about stories about Vietnam for several years before I went over there in 1968. The first thing I noticed when I got off the plane was the smell of two cycle engines. You have to mix the oil with the gas. It smokes like crazy, little putt-putt motorcycles. And so the whole country just kind of smelled of that smoke, in my opinion. Again, being used to Colorado, you can imagine the difference. And to me, it was if I was in a giant theater, maybe not so much of a giant, just imagine Holyoke. You have the screen down there, and you're walking towards the screen. The screen is about Vietnam. They're telling you this, telling you that. And it becomes, as I got closer to the screen, it became more real, and participating in that story. It's just a strange happening, I guess, that I just blended into the war just gradually. They sent me up to Camp Eagle, which is about 50 miles south of DMZ, about 20 miles south of Way. Way was the capital of North Vietnamese, North Vietnam and South Vietnam, before all this fighting started. When the Army builds a base, they just go out in a barren area and start pitching tents. It's strange because little things that you're used to, going to the bathroom, flushing the toilet, you don't have out there. You're just out in the middle of the field. So I won't get into how they get a bit of the we slept in a tent, five people to a tent. After I was there about 2 weeks, Typhoon Bess hit us. It rained 19 inches, about 19 and a half inches in 3 days. And when you have that much water hitting the tent, it leaks through the tent. The tent works for maybe the first 2 or 3 hours, and then the next 2.5 days, it's leaking water through the tent. So we pushed all of our bunks to the center and then draped our ponchos inside. So the water would leak through the tent, hit the ponchos, and then run off in our feet, and then out the tent. If you wanted to take a shower, take a cold shower, you shower in the morning. If you want a hot shower, you shower in the late afternoon. I am not a fan of saluting lieutenants and colonels and majors and generals all day long. So I asked to be on the night shift. The shift is 12 hours deep. One night, I was walking through the camp to the mess hall about 1 o'clock in the morning, and before I finish this story, I need to tell you about incoming and outgoing shells. When you first get there, we have artillery that are shooting out suspected locations of the enemy. So you get used to those boom sounds, and those from artillery units in your own base that are firing out. And then I said, how do you know the difference between incoming and outgoing? And they said, oh, you'll know. It's a slightly louder noise outgoing, and incoming has kind of got a sound to it. And when I first got to Camp Eagle, we got hit about twice a week with 22 millimeter rockets. Any artillery shell is being shot So you get used to these sounds of the guns going out. I'm on my way to the mess hall, and all of a sudden, a loud cut, boom, sounded. And what it was a 2 10-inch guns who just moved into our camp. And of course, I'd never heard the 10-inch guns. I'd heard the 8-inch guns. But it was such a difference in the sound that I was up about this high off the ground, waiting to come down so that I could get flat on the ground and seek shelter someplace. We had a lot of, well, another sound that you get used to is helicopters. We had Huey helicopters and Cobra helicopters. And it's a whop, 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 whop. To this day, if a helicopter goes over and lands in the Holyoke airport, I know whether it's a Huey or not. It's just had that sound. And they mounted rockets on both sides and miniguns on both sides. And a minigun is just like a Gatling gun. And together, they just, the barrel spun like this, and every fifth shell was a tracer. So you could aim your miniguns just by following the tracers, because you knew where they were going. I was told, I don't know if this is true or not, but I was told that if a Cobra helicopter flew over a football field and activated those miniguns, that they'd be putting a round, a bullet round every 6 inches on a football field. That's how much fire pressure, pressure that they could put on the enemy. We had bunkers. The way they build a camp, I start to tell you, is they put the general in the center. And then from the general, they have different motoring units. Of course, we were there, military intelligence. Claymore mines, 30 caliber machine gun. We each had our personal M16s. We had an M79 grenade launcher, and we had a night scope. Night scope just picks up any light in the night, and you shine it out, and they you can see the figures walk. See anything that moves. On the 122 millimeter rockets, the way that the NVA did that, the rockets, is that, say, be in a position over here and fire the rockets towards the camp. We had fire bases out there, and the fire base radar would pick up where that rocket took off from, so then you could, and where it landed. So you could draw a line between those 2 points. And then another fire base, say that was located out here, would do the same thing. So you draw a line from there to here, and there to here, and right here is where they are firing those
crisscross, crisscross, crisscross like that to see if there's anything moving in our area that wasn't us, shouldn't be there. Another, what we had, machine we had was red haze, and that picked up anything that was over the water. So if you drove a car or vehicle or anything, it would pick up that spot and mark it on the map. And then sniffer would fly over the area and detect ammonia. Ammonia is in the urine of your body. So anytime you had a group of soldiers, they weren't going to go to the bathroom right where they stood or they slept or anything like that. They were going to go over, say, behind that tree or someplace out of the way to go to the bathroom. We could pick up those strong ammonia smells. And this is all technology that we had 53 years ago. I don't know, have no idea what they have now, but it was interesting. So what we have now is a map. And on this mylar, we have all this different red haze. And then on the next layer, we have our agent reports. Another mylar, we have actual contacts with the enemy being shot at. So once again, down the rest, but all those sheets of mylar generate a map, and then we will take just a regular piece of paper, the same dimensions as the map. So you want an area that's 1,000 meters wide and 2 to 3,000 meters long. And then you put that on the map and move it around to finally get one that had the most contacts, whether it's interrogation or whatever. So if you had in this area contacts, we would bomb that area and we call them park bombs. They're 500 pound bombs. So the B-52s, of course, are real high. We never saw them, but we could hear them. And when they were having an arc light strike within 5 to 20 miles of us, we could hear them. That would just level that area. I don't know how many of you saw Hamburger Hill, but that's a movie they made out of a battle that took place in my year. It's kind of an anti-war picture in my mind, because what happened is we had a patrol that was out and they received contact with the enemy. So we fell back and we called in a couple of jets and they came in and they dropped some bombs and took off. And we started up the hill again and received more contact from the enemy. So we brought in some more jets. And this kind of premise of the movie is, what good did that do us? You know, we lost a lot of men, and we just leave it. But that's the way a guerrilla war is fought. You're not fighting and holding an area. You're trying to kill as much of the enemy as you can. And that's why they kept the body count in Vietnam. They would keep track of how many NVA soldiers, North Vietnamese, or Viet Cong soldiers we killed. And of course, we kept track of how many soldiers we lost. And I don't know what the number was. Politicians wanted the body count of, say, 50-1. So you would try and keep it down. So we only lost one person for every 20 or 30 or whatever figure they had in mind. Ted Kennedy got up in front of Congress and said, we're losing too many American boys. We need to stop this, do something. And so what happened was we pulled all of our units back to the camp, and we didn't have any operations for 30 days. So for 30 days, we just let the enemy roam around and do whatever they wanted. And the body count, because of operations in other parts of Vietnam, the body count came in line, and the 101st could go out and resume operations. So, to me, it was a political war, and we weren't really, they never really untied our hands to let us win that. I was never wounded. I was probably the closest to being hit. There's a ridge out in front of us, say 50, 60 yards out, and our bunker was right there. So I was on guard duty one night, and there's a rocket that came in and landed over there about, say, 100 yards, and then one landed right in front of us. Say that was 50, 60 yards away. And then the third one landed back towards the center of the camp. So all along, they were trying to hit the general in the center of the camp. But they had to sight that in, so they had a forward observer that was saying, it's too short, too long, so many degrees this way or this way, and that's how they sighted in these rockets. But like I explained earlier, they didn't have very much time to do this, so they go bang, 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 and then just get the hell out of there. That's what they did. I don't know if it's true or not. I made a map of our area, and I put the 6th Regiment that we had trapped up there, and some other where we thought enemy units were. And I was told that they took that map to the Paris Peace Conference. I don't know if that's true or not. I have no way of finding out. But just on the brighter side of things, I just want to tell you that we were allowed to go on R&R. That's where the government would fly. We'd make an appointment. They'd fly us to R&R locations. And I went to Hong Kong for I'd like to take a 7-day leave and go back to Australia. And he said, you haven't had a 7-day leave, Millage? And I said, no, sir. He said, well, God knows you deserve one. And so I got to go back to Australia the same time. So that concludes my report. Is there any questions? So it's 1968 that I went over, and it's 1969 when I came back. I spent the 24th year of my life in Vietnam. Went over my birthday, came back on my birthday. Easy to remember. Question.
How did you view your life after the war?
I'm sorry?
How did you view your life after the war?
How did I view really, what happened after the war is they sent me to Fort Bliss, not Fort Bliss, Colorado Springs. Carson, Fort Carson. Twice a day. You know, the war was over as far as I was concerned. So I went out drinking. But eventually I saw what I was doing to myself, and I went to the first sergeant and said, give me all the legal ways to get out of the door. And so he started. till late in the morning. So I could go eat supper with all the rest of them. And then I would go to the mess hall about 1-2 o'clock in the morning and get something to eat there. And of course, I could eat breakfast when my shift was over. So I could eat three times a day. I played poker with the mess sergeant. And the mess sergeant has a lot of power. If they make, well, just to give an example, I came back at 1 o'clock at night with a lemon meringue pot. The mess sergeant had cooked several pies. And I said, wow, I've never seen a lemon meringue pie that looks so good. And he said, here, take it. And I took it back to the tent where I was working and had two lieutenants and a captain there. And they said, how can you do that? How can you get a pie? We can't even get one thin slice sliver of pie. And you come back with a whole pie. That's just who you know. Any other questions?
Stand up.
Thank you very much.